Hello everyone and welcome to Chai Time with BIX. It's our sixth episode and we're so excited to welcome you again to the Berklee India Exchange space. My name is Annette Philip. And we have Lydia Reynold. I think, okay. Lydia, are you muted?
I fixed it.
Okay. And Lydia is here as well as usual. And a big shout out to our third BIXie, Rohit Jayaraman, who we cannot wait to welcome back to BIX soon. We love and miss you, Ro, if you're watching. A massive BIXie hug from all of us. And we'd love to know where you are joining from. Tell us in the comments, people. And for many of you, if you've joined us before, you know that Chai Time with BIX is very close to our hearts. If you do any sort of creative work, you've probably had some moments of self-doubt or anxiety, or maybe you felt stuck now and then. And this series is about vulnerability and figuring out how to grow as people, how to change the arts industry from within. And before we introduce our guest, Lydia has a few updates for you.
Hi, everyone. So as usual, we would love for this to be as interactive as possible. So before we get into anything, just go and hit that share button, whether it's on YouTube or Facebook, just so that we can bring more people into the room and expand this conversation. So let's just do that right now. Bring your friends. We'd also love for you to stay in touch with us. So take a look at the links to all of our social in the chat right now. We're also including links so that you can subscribe and everything. So if you would do that, that would be amazing so that you can keep in touch. Finally, we're going to do a Q&A as usual at the end. So definitely feel free and do post any questions you have in the chat. I'll be keeping track of them and we will select and pick for the end to round it all up again.
That's right. So Berklee India Exchange, BIX, is known at Berklee for being just a little bit rogue. We love experimenting. We love doing things our own way. And our guest today is no stranger to that mentality. Keba Jeremiah is one of the most ridiculously talented guitarists and producers around. In the entertainment world nowadays, many of you will realize or notice that most often it's the front man, the front woman that gets all the glory, and very rarely a situation where non-vocalists get the same kind of adulation. But Keba, however, he's broken all those sorts of boundaries and stereotypes when it comes to shining through in the industry. His work really speaks for itself. And way beyond his insane guitar chops and versatility as a person, he's one of the most down-to-earth people I've ever met. Kind, funny, wicked smart, a gentle soul, who has really raised the bar as a musician and as a professional. I think for me, most importantly, what I love about Keba is he just keeps it real. So give it up, ladies and gentlemen, Keba Jeremiah.
Hi, guys. Hey, Annette. Hey, Hi. Lydia. Thanks so much for having me on this show.
Keba, so happy that you're here. Right. Tell us about your mug. You have a story.
Right. So you guys can see my mug there. Uh-huh. And generally, people often ask me, where does this name Keba come from? Or, you know, it's an odd name. So, actually Keba is actually a Tamil name. It's from the Tamil Bible. It's kind of very interesting that my parents chose that for me. And, people who get close to me eventually, they start calling me K, you know, and, I've grown to love the. I mean, I know when somebody's calling me K, you know, I know it's someone close to me. So, this cup was gifted by some of my really cool friends. So, yeah,
that's the story behind the cup. I like that. Well, we used to call you K Bear also. I don't know if you ever liked that, but we'll stick with K. Okay, so Lids is going to join us a little bit later. She's going to be compiling all the questions that people have, and we'll see you later, Lids.
See you. Bye-bye.
Okay, so Keba, want to talk about a whole bunch of things, and I'm glad that, you know, we could connect after a long time, actually. And I wanted to start out with some of the things that you mentioned And when I compare it to, you know, a lot of the students that we have at Berklee or just young musicians, many people feel that starting out, the best thing to do for themselves is play, 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 just play a lot. And while it's important to, yes, spend time with your instrument, there is something to be said about learning through observation. And I think you did that a lot. So talk to us about this, especially I think that 2004 period when you moved right from Dubai to Chennai. Talk to us about your mentors and how you learned that way.
Okay. So I moved to Chennai in the year 2004 from Dubai. And that's the period when I really realized I needed to grow as a musician. And initially, when I started playing with a couple of really good musicians out here in Chennai, the moment you start, you take the guitar, you start just playing. You know, you just start playing whatever you want to play. But I realized there was so much more magic in first listening to what others were playing. And whether it was any member in the band, I think I took a lot of interest in listening to all of them. And more, and all of them were pretty senior musicians, way older to me. So I just started listening to them. And often as a guitarist, you think you can only learn from listening to a guitarist. No, you can learn from listening to every single member of the band. Sometimes you can learn a lot just by listening to a vocalist, just the way they do a particular vibrato or a particular run. And you know, those things, and how you translate it to the guitar. So I started listening a lot. So even when I had to start learning songs for gigs, one of the first things I do, even today, is I usually take a paper and a pen and I sit down and I play the song a couple of times and I start writing down a chord chart. And I try to understand why I write the chord the way I write it. Why do I hear it a certain way? And then I try to compare it with people, you know, because it's funny how a lot of musicians can hear the same section of a song differently. And it's also because as musicians, sometimes we tend to hear our favorite section of the song. Some people just listen to the piano parts. Some people just listen to what the bass guitar is playing. So, and so the way they translate the chords will be very different. Right. So I, till today, I love just spending a lot of time first listening to a piece of music before I take my instrument and you know, maybe start playing on it.
Yeah. Were there, you know, some mentors specifically in Chennai who, you know, maybe something that someone said that kind of shifted you, you know, as a person, as a musician, was there something that stood out to you that was pivotal?
Yeah, I mean, there was a keyboardist called Daniel who used to play with me. Uh-huh. He's a pretty senior person in the industry. And he always used to let me play. But at the same time, he would ask if I knew what I was playing, you know, and did I know what I was playing? And have I heard it in the original or was it just jamming on the song? And a lot of times I would watch him play and he would beautifully transcribe the song. You would have it, you know, note for note. Wow. And I realized that kind of detailing is what I want to do. I want to be able to, you know, learn the small things that make a huge difference. And that's what I started working towards. I think it's great to play, I mean, 1,000 notes and impress someone. But can you play one note and impress someone? Can that one note touch somebody? And that's something I'm still striving towards.
I love that. I think a lot of, especially young musicians, do need to hear that reminder. Thank you. And, you know, to continue on that line about listening, I think it's also interesting about how your career started to build, because you never made a demo tape, right, in your life. Everything came to you by word of mouth. So people hearing about you from others.
Yes.
What were you doing specifically that was leading to this, you know, people spreading the good word about Keba? What was that?
I think from the moment I started, I made it a point to whatever job I took up, I made sure I completed the job. So for me, completing a job was really important and giving the required result. that was expected of the composer or the producer. And I think that's something that really stood out to people. I'd always make sure I am on time. I try my best to be on time. It's super hard in India. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I don't think it's okay to give excuses. I think you have to, you know, you work the timings out, you know if there's going to be traffic. And so you adjust accordingly. But I somehow try to be there on time. And these all things are things that people started to notice. And I think people were very kind to me. And a lot of people have been really, really kind to me over the years. And they just went and shared with their friends. And honestly, till today, I really don't have anything that I've actually sent out to a music composer.
Yeah.
They've basically either heard a piece of music that I played for someone, or they've just trusted a close friend of theirs who shared something with them.
Mm.
And I think I've been super blessed throughout this journey.
Well, you've had consistency in your in the standard that you provide as a professional. And I remember you mentioned also that you take extra everything, right? Talk about that, because I think more people need to hear about that.
Yeah. Okay. So if I go for a session, I go fully prepared. I make sure I have a backup of everything. I usually carry an acoustic guitar, a classical guitar, an electric guitar. I carry my bass also with me. But for every set of guitar, I carry an extra pair of strings. And I don't carry just one pair of strings. I carry two sets of extra strings, because what if the string I replace breaks, you know?
Right.
So, But the funny thing is, I think it's been over 7 or 8 years since I've broken a string, you know?
Yeah.
But I still carry it, because you have to be prepared for the worst. You have to be.
You never know.
And I'm fascinated with tuners. I love tuners. I love guitar tuners. So it's
What
so
is it funny. That fascinates you about it?
Oh, I have it right here.
Sure.
This is like a box that I carry. So there'll be one, two, there'll be at least 5-6 tuners.
Gotcha.
But I love these tiny tuners. And so I carry extra tuners. Then I carry batteries for the tuners. And I always walk into a session with at least 50 picks, different kinds of picks, because the thickness of a pick can make a huge difference in the way your guitar sounds. So I think being prepared is really, really, it's about doing a little bit of homework before you go for a session. Mm-hmm. And I'm always prepared for the worst, because I've seen certain guitars walk into sessions and a string snaps, and then they don't know what to do. And it's an awkward situation for everybody, because everybody's actually made time to be there on that day. So I always make sure I take this extra effort of carrying extra cables, extra everything, extra headphones, just extra everything.
It's beautiful. I think more people need to do that. And you know what else was interesting to me about the word of mouth is that even your parents actually got convinced because they were hearing, right? Tell us that story.
Okay. So my parents initially weren't very convinced about the whole music thing.
Mm.
They were like, music's good. You play music, but it's a hobby. And
we've never heard that before, right? So
So eventually I started doing a lot of music and a lot of sessions. And what I love is that people used to go and meet my parents. My parents were still in Dubai back then. Mm. They were not in India.
Mm.
So like people used to visit from here and go back to Dubai. They used to be like, we saw your son in this video. We saw your son at this concert. So it's so good for me, because I never had to convince my parents. Other people were convincing my parents that, see, I think he's good at what he does. So eventually my parents, they've really supported me.
Yeah.
And now they just totally love what I do, and they're so supportive.
Aww. And at the same time, you did finish, you again, what I'm seeing is a pattern like in your life that you finish things, which because you did mechanical engineering, right? And you're good at it. Yeah.
I don't know if I'm good at it, but
you're being modest now.
No, but see, my parents just had one rule. They were just like, do the engineering, which like most Indian parents get a degree. So they were like, get a degree and then do whatever you want.
Okay.
And honestly, it didn't seem like a hard thing initially, because for the first 2 years, it was okay. I was able to go to college.
Sure.
By the third year, I started gigging a little bit, doing a little bit of recordings. And then by the fourth year, I had an attendance problem. But then just this one thing that my parents said, they said, finish it and do whatever you want.
Right.
So I just pushed through. I really pushed through, and I finished in 4 years. And I mean, I finished with good marks, and, you know, so.
Yeah.
So it does, yeah.
It's good.
I think it's important as a musician also to be consistent.
Right.
And so I think it's a little bit of a pattern that I followed, just being consistent and trying to finish what I start. So that's really important.
I like it. And of course, I know that, you know, over time, you were just getting more and more busy. And, you know, when it rains, it pours. At some point, you're just inundated with requests. And now I hear that you have a kind of a opportunity filtering system, like a Keba filtration system. Tell us about that, which helps you choose kind of what to do and what not to do, right? Okay. Projects.
So one of the first things I do is I ask any composer or any producer to email me the scratch track that they have. And I take time to listen to it and figure out, number one, if it is in my zone, if I can do justice to the track. And first of all, to see if it's neatly programmed, because lately we just have so many music producers, and music producers who sit and do a lot of music in front of the laptop, but have they actually gone through the process of learning music theory? Do they know what they are doing? Have they learned what they are playing? Are they able to interpret what they are playing? Are they able to explain what they've programmed to another musician? And that's a struggle that I've had over the years in a studio, because I've been to many sessions where I would be sitting and playing. I know the song and I know the chord that's on the track. I know that's an A major, it's a D major, it's an E major. But then they say something like, I want this place to have something that's exciting.
Okay.
So in my head, I'm like, so what are you exactly looking for?
Right.
I just want something fast-paced. I just want something just to, you know, just to be busy. And so you see, these are not
musical terms.
Yeah. These are not musical terms. It's really hard to. So it's important that music producers learn music theory. It is really, really important. That's the only way you can effectively convey what you want a musician to produce in the studio. So I had this struggle for a few years, which is why I have this filtration system where I make it a point to listen to every track that comes to me. And the second thing is I really make sure that they know how to write a chord chart. And I ask producers, can you send me a chord chart? And that's where 50% of the work is done, because most of them don't send a chord chart. You know, and I've had this system for a long time where every time when I listen to a track, I usually take a paper and a pen, and I love writing. I don't know, I love writing chords, and we did this a lot.
Yeah.
And you must remember, we did
a
lot of chord writing.
And we did a lot of chord cross-checking also, where there were many weird interpretations.
And that's the beautiful thing.
Yeah.
It's the same piece of music, but everybody's hearing it differently.
Exactly.
Yeah, so this is one of the things I do. I make sure they write a good chord chart. And so a lot of my work gets done that way, as in a lot of the filtration gets done that way, because a lot of the younger music producers who come in really haven't studied their theory. And everybody assumes making beats is making music. No, making beats is not making music. You know, I mean, you may be able to make cool beats, but that's not music in its entirety.
That's not all of it, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, music is rhythm and harmony. So the harmony part of things is where a lot of people are struck. And especially what I've found in the past 10 years is that in India, everything is melody driven. So there's no focus on harmony. So when it comes to doing back on a song, composers are usually giving me melody lines. Mm-hmm. Nobody's giving me chords, and you know,
and that's the whole arrangement, basically.
Yeah. It's great to have a lot of lines on the song,
right?
But it's the arrangement and the harmony changes that can really, really change the song.
I mean, it contextualizes everything in a totally different feel. Yeah.
So I wish more composers would really, and more young musicians would take a lot of time to just spend their time going back to their basics. And that's something I do all the time. I'm always revisiting my basics, because you really need to have strong foundations in music. Yeah,
that's cool. And I think, you know, I think what I'm hearing from you is that it's not just important to have a benchmark or a standard for yourself. It's equally important in your career to also hold your collaborators to some of those standards.
Yes.
That's something that I haven't actually heard many people say. And I think especially, you know, musicians really need to keep that in mind. And I like that. I like that as a concept, even to, it's great teaching moment, you know?
Yeah.
The other thing is that, you know, a lot of people, I've had this where, oh my goodness, which one do I choose? You know, and in many situations, you'll get advice from people in the industry. Okay, make sure you're strategically choosing the shinier, more glamorous, more glitzy, more star power opportunity. And I, you know, what I like about your filtration system is A, that you have benchmarks, but B, that once you've committed, you stay with that, right?
Yeah,
so you have some stories that I think our audience would love to hear about.
So I mean, how it works for me is pretty simple. I get a bunch of dates from a lot of people. I have a calendar and I put the dates into the calendar. And it's quite simple. If I commit to doing something on a date, I'm committed to that particular person. So it's a very first come, first serve basis. It's like a very, it's I think something we learn in computer science, like FCFS, first come, first serve. So I've always had that with me. But what happens is with event companies and managements managing different artists, the moment a management realizes you're playing for a big artist, they try to convince you that playing for the smaller artist or playing for the artist who doesn't have as much recognition is not worth it, you know. But for me, it's more of a principle rather than the glamour or the money. See, sometimes definitely the money is better.
Yeah.
But I'm not doing it for the money. I'm doing it because of the principle, you know. And I've had really tough situations. I've had people say nasty things to me. I've been a victim of like arm twisting and all kinds of stuff just to make sure I go for the glamorous gig. But I think eventually people realize that whatever they try is not going to change, you know? So they take the extra effort to make sure they give me the date earlier. So, you know, that's a way you can work the system. You be committed to what you do, and I think the system changes for you.
Yes. Preach. You know? Keba. Yes. Yeah, so,
and it's funny because now for some of the gigs, I get the dates earlier, way earlier than some of the singers, which is, it's a very interesting thing. They would give me and a couple of other artists the dates way earlier than the singers. Or they would say, man, this date is coming up and we don't know if it's confirmed, but please, hold it.
Yeah.
And I'm okay with that. Yeah. I'm okay, but just let me know.
Right.
And so that's something.
It makes your word have value throughout the system. And I love that this is how you're playing the system, you know? It's on your own terms and it's with integrity, which I love. And I would you mind sharing the incident when you first met Mansur, because that is a mind-blowing story.
Yeah.
That's in terms of integrity. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. That's a really, really interesting story because I think as a young musician, for a young musician in India, the dream is to play for the biggest composer in India.
Yeah.
And I never dreamt that that would happen for me. I never dreamt. And singer Srinivas, I've been playing for him for a while. And I was doing a couple of live gigs for him. And one day he was like, you should meet AR. And he has to listen to you play. And I was like, sure. If it happens, it happens.
Right.
And I still remember I was in between a rehearsal and then I got the call. And singer Srinivas was like, come to the studio. And he wants to hear you.
Okay.
And I always have my guitars in my car. So I drive to the studio and I walk into the studio. And Rahman says like, do you have your guitar with you? And I'm like, yes, I have my guitar. Hmm. And he's like, play something. And I still don't remember what I played. But I know I just played a bunch of chords, you know, nothing too fancy. Just kept it simple. And he asked me, where did you learn this? And I said, I, you know, mostly learned by ear, by watching a lot of people playing, by watching a lot of YouTube videos. And there were a bunch of people in the room.
Right.
And he was like, let's record tomorrow. And I already had a commitment the next day. I had a gig the next day. So I was like, sir, I'm sorry, but I can't record tomorrow. And, you know, I could just hear like this, everybody's like,
hush in the room.
There's a hush, but there's also everybody's mind voice going, what has this guy done? You know? And Srinivas would have, actually, singer Srinivas would have thought, because...
Yeah, like, who is this guy I brought?
What's up with this kid? You know? And but I still clearly remember the words that Rahman said. He told me, it's good that you have these principles, and these principles will take you a long way in life. And this was back in 2010.
Right.
Okay. And that happened. That whole episode happened, and I left the studio in 2010. And I didn't get a call for a long time. And I think I got a call maybe like 5 to 6 months later. And I still remember I was playing in the studio, and he just comes up to me and he says, "Great tone. I love your playing." And it's amazing because it's been 10 years and I'm still to this day, I'm playing, you know. In fact, during the lockdown, they've sent me a couple of tracks that I worked at home. So, and it's also become, it's also a lot of trust that we've built over the years.
Right.
I don't know how many musicians he says this to, but usually when there's a recording, I'll go for the session and I'd be like, "Sir, what's the idea here? Do you have a plan of what needs to be done?"
Right.
And he's, you know what to do. Whatever you play sounds good. And to get that kind of a compliment from someone like him is amazing. And I don't think this whole thing would have happened if it weren't for the principle I had set early on of being committed to what I had initially planned to do. So, I mean, it's eventually paid off.
Really, I mean, that inspires so many people because I think also India culturally, you know, we have... there is a power dynamic that we not only grow up in, we also continue to feed that system, the power dynamic and the fear of saying no to someone who you have a perception of being higher than you, either in age or in status or in, you know, power itself, authority, position. And that needs to change. That's another way that I feel like you're really... you know, changing the system for yourself again. And the respect that comes from that and the integrity that it is born from is a beautiful thing to witness. So all power to you for doing that, you know, way back in your early days. So
thanks so much.
Now that we're talking about industry, this is a good segue. One of the things that, you know, at least with Berklee India Exchange, like we said earlier, we're a little bit rogue. You know, we often will experiment and mess around with things. And we love to dream up what it is that A, we want to do and where we want to go. And also, what's the dream for the industry? So I want to throw some things at you and I want to get your opinion on these aspects. And, you know, as a pro and as, I mean, you're a veteran now in the industry. I mean, you've played with pretty much everybody. You've really made your mark and you haven't compromised your principles. So what are those things that you wish for? So first of all, even just as a guitarist, you know, like when you talk about tone, the thing that Rehman sir complimented you on.
Yeah.
Talk about that and the struggle that you have and what you wish with it could be.
Yeah. Okay. So basically in India, we have this whole, we've had this struggle with analog gear for a long time.
Mm.
I don't know how it's in other places, but in India, it's been a little bit of a struggle.
Mm.
So initially when I started out playing the guitar, you're always in search for that better sound. Everybody's always in search for how can I sound a little bit better than yesterday. So I started buying a lot of analog gear and a lot of analog pedals, and this started making this nice pedal board. And eventually I had a nice setup, but in India you have this constraint where studios really don't have amps or where you can really plug in the guitar to get a good sound. So eventually people are really not bothered about the sound, but they like just bring a guitar and just plug it in straight to the straight into the sound card. And so what happens with a situation like that is when you give a signal like that, which is a direct signal, they are able to manipulate the sound as to however they want it to sound.
Right.
But eventually that is not your sound, that's not your tone. And something that plays so dynamically with something that you've with the sound that you've chosen can sound so different with just some processing and maybe using a different set of amps or just thinking differently from how you think.
Right.
So that's the struggle that's happening right now as far as recording is concerned, because people are really the industry is so driven by let's just get this done today. Let's not focus on the sound. As long as he's just a guitar player and he's just playing, let's just take what we have to do and then we can just edit it out and we can, you know, manipulate it however we want. And honestly, I feel there's only so much that technology can fix.
Right.
There's technology can never replace the human aspect of music, you know, and I think that's what makes music so beautiful, the human side of things, you know.
Yeah.
And but what everybody's doing lately has been they've been trying to make it a very mechanical process where they try to just edit the music that you play or change the tone, and it's they kind of like treat you as though you were a, what do you say, like a VST or like a
just
a
MIDI, like a plugin. Another MIDI instrument. Yeah.
You're just like another MIDI instrument, and they don't want to capture who you are in the song.
They basically
I think that's really important. So that that struggle has been there.
Yeah, because I want to point out, you know, also because I know that we have some musicians, but also some people who are not into music full time. And the it's such an interesting thing because what tone we have colors the story.
Yes.
You know, you are a storyteller as a musician, period. It's not that you're a storyteller as a vocalist only. You as a guitarist, as a drummer, as, you know, even someone who's just playing one triangle, you know, if you watch a movie and you start to, you know, tune into the background score.
Yeah.
And if you watch a horror movie without the music versus with the music, it's such a different emotional, psychological experience because the music is coloring everything. And so you understand you know, how important even one triangle sound or a manjira sound or a, you know, whatever it is coloring everything. And especially as a guitarist, especially as an instrument that does both melody and harmony, tone is everything. Yeah. And oftentimes, so that I agree with you. I also wish, A, on live gigs and in studio, that people would invest in gear or allow for you to have time to set up a pedal board and choose. Yeah. And I also wish that more people, more musicians who play those instruments would take time to finesse their sound. Just like a chef will get great knives.
Yeah.
You know, like that's the kind of the way I feel it. So love that. And actually, this is a good segue. Let's talk about, I think we have a common shared hope for the future where the hierarchy in a band is non-existent.
Yeah.
Right? Because there's two things. One is the singer versus the non-singers. And then there's also in the band itself, there's this weird power dynamic that's happening. So talk to us about your wish.
So my wish is that everybody on stage just gets seen as a musician.
Right.
Everybody is equal, and without one member of the team, the job doesn't get done. The sound is the collective sound of everybody. It's not the sound of just one. The song is the collective sound of everybody. And it's like everybody's an individual member of the body. It's like hands and feet. Mm-hmm. But only if all of them function together does the whole thing, you know, sound perfect. So we've had this problem here where generally it's assumed that the vocalist is everything in the band, you know, and musicians also, we've for a while been like, okay, we cannot give them that role. Like, okay, it's the whole song is about the vocalist. Mm-hmm. But lately, you know, it's so to see young musicians and a lot of people really finding their role in the band and they've understood the importance of what they do. Unless you realize how important every note you play is, you don't feel like you're a part of the band. And so that's something that's been really changing over the years. And I hope it just continues in this way so that, I guess, everybody is seen as an equal member in the band. Right. And then within the band itself, what we usually have is, like musicians feel like maybe the guy who does the solo is the better, the guy who gets the solo sections, he's the better musician. But it really isn't that way, you know, like whether you're playing the smallest part of the song or whether you're playing a backing throughout the song, these are, you are playing an important part. You are playing a part that is a part of the song. And I think it makes a lot of sense, when all the members of the band can come to that kind of a dynamic where they respect each other for what they do.
Yeah.
And once that happens, I think the band sounds a lot better. I think when that kind of band chemistry is developed, I think the band just sounds a lot better.
Mm-hmm.
And I think people can see that, and people can feed off that energy.
They
can really feed off. Mm-hmm. Because I've noticed in bands where we can just talk freely to each other, and, you know, we just share our thoughts, and I can give suggestions. They may be a way better drummer, but I can just give a suggestion where maybe you can just back off on this section a little bit, you know, and where I'm able to talk freely. Yeah. When I can freely discuss these things with musicians, I find that when we go on stage, that the whole energy is different, and we come across as like a happy bunch of people to everybody.
Yeah.
And so for some reason, they just enjoy the music more.
I totally agree.
Yeah. So, and this system is really improving. Like I do play with a couple of bands here where there is no hierarchy. The singer travels with us, the singer hangs out with us, which doesn't happen in a lot of cases. The singer has their own whatever executive room and they hang out by themselves. But I just love it when we are all just, you know, just hanging out together. I think that whole idea of just hanging out together can change the whole vibe of the band. It can make a huge difference.
Yeah, I honestly think that you haven't quite played together till you had a meal together. I mean, I've always felt that. I mean, I think for the Indian ensemble, there's always a little bit of biryani or something that, you know, it needs to happen, right?
So yeah.
Cool. I love at least these two. I know. I think we have a couple of interesting audience questions. And then I have some funny questions also for you.
All right.
Because we've talked a lot of concepts. So maybe I'll bring Lydia, come back, and we have some questions. Maybe we can take Shine's question first, Suhasini. Sure. Yeah.
All right. Well, she's curious to hear what your routine is, especially before a concert or a gig. Do you have like a practice routine of how many hours you put into it, or is there something structured about it?
Okay. There is a certain sense of structure before I go into a gig. Number one, I make sure the material comes to me early, whatever needs to be learned. I try my best to have all my charts ready before the gig. All my charts have to be ready before the gig. Even if they are written incorrectly, it's okay, but have charts. Mm-hmm. It's better to go prepared with something than to go with nothing at all. You know, and I have my charts ready. Then I make sure all my gear is tuned, it's all ready, it's all polished. I don't want to turn up to a gig and then have a pickup issue or have issue with strings or have some electrical issues. I make sure all that is sorted. And one of the things I do is I make sure I do a little bit of warm-up always before I go for a rehearsal. Because sometimes it's like a knowledge versus, it's like a head versus the body kind of a, it's a battle, because sometimes you know the music up here, but then the body isn't responding to it. So I always enjoy doing these small warm-ups before I go on stage, just to make sure, you know, I just don't get stuck at a point or something. But I mean, there is a certain amount of structure that is there before I go for a gig.
That's cool. Do you have a, I mean, do you still get nervous?
I do get, depends on who I'm performing with, but like you said, if I've had a meal with everyone in the band, I'm not too nervous, I think. I think, if I've had a meal with everyone, it's a little more chilled out. Yeah,
that's
good. Is it a trust thing? Like, because you feel more like everyone's got your back, or like, how does that play into you feeling?
Yeah, I mean, that's also the, I mean, It's so cool when, like, even when you make a mistake, when somebody can, like, look at you and, you know, you can have a good laugh on stage and not be judgmental or be like, you know, because at the end of the day, we're all humans and, you know, I mean, errors do happen. But I think that if somebody can have your back that way, it's just amazing. And those are fun moments. Those are moments that we just love on stage, where something accidental happens, and it could be good or it could be bad, you know? So, I mean, those are fun moments on stage.
Yeah, totally. Lydia, there was a question, I think one of our young fans had asked about your first guitar or something like that.
Somebody wanted to know, what was your first guitar?
Because we see all these amazing guitars behind you.
My first guitar.
Yeah.
It's that guitar.
Oh my God, will you bring it? Are you able to?
Okay, you need to hear the story about that guitar.
Okay.
So that guitar is older than me.
Okay. Wow.
So, okay. So basically my dad wanted to learn guitar and he bought that guitar.
Okay.
And then we kids were born. And every time he started learning the instrument, we'd go and disturb him. So he never learned it, and he put it up. He just packed it away and put it up. And then when I initially started going for guitar classes when I was 6 or 7, that was the first guitar that he gave to me. So it's way older than me, but I've still had it, and it's just a great memory.
Do you still play it?
It's not in the best condition, but it just looks instrument. It looks nice. So
have you named it? Because I have a thing that I name my instruments. I don't know if you're that kind of person.
I haven't named all my guitars, but just that extreme one on the extreme one on that corner, that guitar is Zipora. But the rest of them are just
Zipora.
Yeah. Zipora.
Oh, yeah. What's the story behind that?
I think that's a guitar I got that made in Finland.
Mm-hmm.
And it's a guitar that it took over 1 year to build. And I was there right from the selection of the wood. And every single detail of the guitar. So it was really special because I watched the entire journey from wood to what it is now, you know. And
that's beautiful.
So I thought I should give it a name. That's what I call it, Zipora now. Yeah.
It's a her.
Her, yeah.
Ah, okay. Cool. Well, it's kind of like you're a baby, you know, you birth it, right?
All my babies, yeah.
Yeah, it's so sweet. Yeah. I love that. Lids, any other questions? I think there were some very technical questions also, which is great.
There was a question about how do you maintain the balance in your standard between all of the instruments you play, like between acoustic, guitar, electric, and bass? Like, how do you upkeep your own standard and maintain it?
Okay, so I make sure that I spend individual time with each instrument. I think the general assumption is just because I play the acoustic, I can play the electric and I can play the bass, but no. Each instrument is different. They have their own individual techniques. They have their own individual sound, you know? And it's so interesting because sometimes guitar players also tend to play a lot of stuff in the lower register.
Mm.
There are times when they play in the lower register and that eats into the register of the bass guitar. So, I mean, you really need to understand the sound of the instrument. And that's something I make specific times for. I make specific practice times for each instrument.
Mm-hmm.
And with regards to sound of each instrument, I'm always in search of a better sound. I don't think you can ever arrive at the best sound. I think that's a lifelong journey. Mm-hmm. And I think I'm still in search of that journey and still in search of that sound. And I think I love playing the acoustic guitar and I'm still in search of like the perfect sound. It has to sound like butter to me. The moment I just hold it, it has to melt, you know? And so every time I travel, I'm still always, I go to a lot of stores and I play a lot of guitars. Always searching for maybe a sound that I'll eventually be satisfied with. Yeah,
it's like your guitar soulmate.
Yeah.
So sweet. I want to talk though about one question, just going off of the audience, is that you know, that medium between perfection or a perfect sound versus a human sound.
Okay.
Because, a lot of us struggle with that. And I want to give an example also. A student of mine recently had a recording that we were editing. And she just wouldn't let one note, literally one note, was slightly sharp. And she wouldn't let it go. She just couldn't. It was like an insult to her to leave it. And we felt something from that. So, you know, do you struggle with that at all?
I struggle with it a lot. So much. I struggled with it. In fact, so it's an interesting story. So playing with the click, with the metronome, in between became a craze for me, you know?
Obsession? Like it
was an obsession.
Yeah.
So when I looked at a session, all my notes had to be on the grid. It became so much of an obsession at a point. I still remember going to record it and I so perfectly. That's what I thought, wow, I've played this session so perfectly. And then I still remember the composer telling me, Keba, if we wanted this, we could have just used an VST. We didn't have to call you. We want the humanness of what you have to offer. And that really changed my perspective, you know?
Yeah.
It's the human things that make music what it is.
Mm-hmm.
It's the human side of, it's a small deviations from the grid. It's the small pulls, it's the small pushes. It's those things that make music what it is. So I think you have to find the perfect balance. It's a struggle. It's a struggle for me even today. Like I completely get what you're saying with a student of yours, because I play, when I play a solo on a song, and I'll be sitting in the room and I'll be watching everybody's reactions. Because there might be one note that is like super off for me, but it might be just 5 cents off, but it's still off for me. And I'll be watching everybody in the room and everybody will be so happy, you know, and I have to let go. Sometimes it's just about, okay, it's working for the song. You have to let go, you know, and it's a struggle. It is a struggle.
Yeah. Well, thank you for sharing that. I have tons of other questions. Do we have any other audience things, or shall I just keep firing away?
Well, there's a very technical question, which I'm not even entirely...
Do it. Do it. Why not? We've got...
I actually don't know how to pronounce this
gauge
word. Is it gauge?
It's the gauge. Yeah, the gauge. Yeah.
What gauge do you use in your electric and acoustic?
Okay.
Nice.
So, yeah, this is a great question. Okay, so the gauge... plays a huge difference in your sound. So it's
explain
actually,
also
it's,
what it is,
yeah,
please.
Yeah. Okay. So the gauge is the thickness of the string that you use for your guitar. So the thinner the strings you use, the easier it is to play. But the thicker the strings you use, the fatter your sound is. So it's a comp. It's a fight between tone versus playability. You know, and if you really want to shred and play fast, you have to use thinner gauges, you know, but you lose out on tone. So where do you draw the line? So with the acoustic guitar, I've used 1253 for years. I use the Elixir strings and I've used 1253 for years. And a lot of guitarists don't use it. They find it incredibly hard to play. It's thick, but it sounds fat and it sounds full. And I've loved it. And Elixir strings always sound great. So that's for acoustic. But for electric, even for electric, I use 1046, which again, a lot of guitarists find a little too thick, but it's at the end of the day, it's tone. So it's a battle. You have to choose. It's tone versus playability. And that's something you have to choose for yourself.
So. And it's also a muscle memory, because it's not that you can't train your body to get accustomed to a harder, right?
Yeah.
A higher gauge string.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
But of course, you have to have the time to work on that.
Yeah.
And speaking about time, I have a follow-up question. You know, I know for myself, and I'm sure this happens to you, when I get a long tour, like actually this month I was supposed to be on a 3-month tour and we did about 1.5. You know, when you say yes to something, you also say no to something else. And I remember getting to a point where I realized, okay, I'm going to think with an abundance mindset that this is actually good for me right now. And that also anything that I miss during this time, if it's needed, if it's meant to be, it's going to come back, versus the scarcity mindset where, oh my God, I'm going to miss this, I'm going to miss that. So how have you dealt with that, especially with touring, and what's your take on it?
So I've had instances where sometimes a big tour comes up and you're not in town for a month. But during that month, I'd get a recording with one of the biggest composers for one of the biggest songs. And in my head, I'd be like, oh my God, what's happening? You know, so do I give up on the live scene or do I give up on the recording scene, you know? But I've eventually learned to let go, because I've learned that sometimes it's just better to let go. I think better opportunities always come if you are committed and focused to what you've decided to do. And it's just worked out incredibly well. If a composer really wants you and they really want your sound, I think they will wait for you.
Yeah.
Or they will find a way to make it work, you know?
Yeah.
And as far as live gigs are concerned, I use live gigs as a, I think for me, that's the best time I find as a way to relax. I love, I love doing the live thing because that's the break I get from just going to sessions and, you know, from the grind.
Yeah.
And that's the time I get to really explore a city or a town and explore nature. And there's so much you can learn from just being with nature, just listening to, I think listening to silence is amazing. You know, sometimes just, there's so, I mean, you know, like listening to silence, I think there's, I find that, you know, just, I feel so, there's so much calmness, there's so much, and there's so many things. So, but I basically find it as a good time to rest for me. You know, in the lighting, a lot of people look at it very differently. I mean, they look at it very, as a very stressful period and stuff. But I think for me, it's, I love the sleep. I mean, that's the best time I get to sleep because I'm always doing sessions when I'm here and at home. So yeah, I enjoy doing that.
It's also, when you talked about sleep, I will never forget you know, our bus tour, like 2015, the sleep on a tour bus.
Yeah.
it's beautiful.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And we had so much fun. We played so many games and, you know, I mean, and those kind of experiences are just different experiences, which you don't get when you're just in a studio kind of a mode and just going from session to session.
Yeah. Agree. So we have, it's actually, I'm so happy to see more technical questions. Let's do them as rapid fire.
Okay.
So Akash is asking, do you shuffle between using a mic and the pickup for recording acoustics, acoustic sessions, or do you do both?
So I don't do the pickup anymore.
Haha, good.
I don't. I believe that a guitar has to be captured as it is heard, as naturally as it is heard. So I don't do pickup at all. I haven't done it for over 6-7 years.
Nice.
I don't do pickup anymore.
Cool. Siddharth asks, and Lydia, you can lead these Siddharth's question. You see it?
He asked how to choose the guitar action and like what's the difference in tone between low, medium, and high action.
Okay. So a low action means your string is as close as possible to your fretboard. But what happens is the moment it gets really close, when you do bends or stuff, bends or you do some vibrato, you tend to get buzz noise. Your sustain immediately reduces. So are you looking for a long sustain? If you're looking for a longer sustain, make sure your action is a little higher. But if your action is a little higher, your playability becomes a lot more harder. So these are compromises that you have to decide for yourself.
Mm-hmm.
It's the sound that you are looking, it's the sound that you are trying to create for yourself. So you have to decide where you want to draw the line between these factors.
Cool.
Makes sense.
Yeah. Okay, I'm going to do very, very quick ones, okay? What's the secret of your hair? What's your hair routine? Short answer.
Mm-hmm. Wash it every day. Wash and condition daily.
Condition daily, wash and condition daily. Vav. Okay. But because your actual hair is wavy, right? I mean,
it's a little wavy.
Like from way back.
Yeah, it is wavy. But now I just wash and condition daily, especially
nice.
Chennai weather.
Just a moment.
Yeah. All right. And best podcast, because I recently found out that you like podcasts. So what's one that we should all listen to?
So I listen to a lot of stuff when I drive.
Uh-huh.
It's just random podcasts. And I listen to a lot of podcasts when I drive. But the podcast that I listen to a lot is, I listen to a lot of church sermons when I drive. Yeah, because
nice.
I find that's the best time that I get to listen because I don't get time to read.
Right.
So when I drive, I spend a lot of time driving to sessions.
Mm-hmm.
So I listen to this pretty famous preacher called Rick Warren. He's written a book called The Purpose-Driven Life. So, I mean, I kind of listen to his podcast a lot.
Yeah, it also, I feel like if you're listening to something inspiring or calming, you're a chiller in traffic.
Yeah, definitely. I love, it's funny. I mean, people don't understand how I enjoy driving, but I love driving. And I don't get mad at all at traffic. I mean, I enjoy the reactions of people when they get mad, because it's just so funny. The whole experience is just so funny for me. But I enjoy driving. Yeah, I just enjoy
driving. That's cool. So, and, you know, talking about driving and traveling, I know you love to travel. So let's say COVID is over and you have no obligations. Where do you want to go next?
One of the first cities would be Singapore.
Yes.
I love Singapore. I love Singapore.
You know, also, I grew up there, right?
Oh, I didn't know that.
We
okay. Yes. I remember. Yeah. Okay. So, I mean, I love everything about Singapore, but one of the reasons is one of my favorite guitar companies is there. It's called Maestro Guitars. And every time I go there, they treat me like family, you know? And it's every time I go to the store, they bring out 50, 60 guitars and they're like, try this. And, you know, it's such a fun experience for me. But I mean, I love the city. I love the food. I love the people. So.
Yeah, cool. Singapore is beautiful and beautiful weather as well.
Yes.
Okay, let's say one last thing, which is, you know, you always keep it real. And I think that, I mean, even for me with BIX, Lydia keeps it real, like really real. And so what's the best and maybe weirdest or hardest thing you've ever heard from a friend? I'm not sure why I chose this question to end with, but you're just real. So give us a real story, a real moment.
I think some of the hardest from a friend, I think it's from my brother, my younger brother. Mm-hmm. We used to play a lot back in the day. Mm-hmm. We used to play together in a band. And, you know, there are times when you play a gig and you feel like, man, this was a good. And then my brother walks up to me and he's like, man, you sounded so shitty. Your tone sounded so bad. And, you know, and it's those kind of those moments that actually really, really helped me. Sometimes you just in your head, you think you achieved it all. But, you know, I love the fact that he could just bring me back down and, you know, you have something to work on. Mm-hmm. And that's something that I always love to hear from friends. Friends who can give some constructive criticism, just love it. Yeah.
It's beautiful. Wow. Well, I think we should end on that, because, yeah, keeping it real is it's underrated nowadays.
Yes.
Yeah. So, Keba, thank you for being with us, and thank you for being candid and being honest and vulnerable, and just for being yourself and introducing us to your guitar family.
All right.
And
thanks for having me. I mean, this has been like different from a lot of the other interviews I've done, but this has been so much fun, because I don't know if I've spoken so technical on a lot of other things. And some of the music topics, I don't think I've ever spoken about ever, you know? So it's been really interesting and it's been real fun. Thank you so much.
Let's do it again. Let's not leave this long before we talk again.
Definitely.
And maybe we'll all meet in Singapore next.
Definitely.
Okay. And actually, Keba, if you get a chance, there's a whole bunch of other technical questions. I think a lot of musicians realize that for once they're going to get their, you know, their questions answered. So if you feel like we have sent your social media to everybody, and maybe they'll get in touch with you, and or, you know, we'll set up another session. I think, actually, I have a question for the audience. Would you like Keba to do a workshop on technique and tone and just, you know, Keba-ness? If you want to, I want to know in the comments right now. And we'll request Keba and see if we can make that happen. It would be cool to have you do a Berklee workshop for us.
Definitely. I'm just reading the comments now. Actually, I didn't realize
that there was.
Yeah, I'm just reading it now. Oh,
cool. All right. Well, one big extra BIXie hug and thank you. And we have a tradition that we hold up our mugs. So your K mug is there and somebody or the other is going to take a screenshot. Yay! You're so quiet. Good.
All right.
Thanks you, Keba.
So much fun.
So much love and thanks for being yourself. Really.
Thanks so much. Thank you so much. Thank you so much. I hope we do this, you know, soon, you know, catch up soon. And Let's do.
We can have a chai time with BIX Keba part two and whatever else you feel like, because I know we just scratched the surface in terms of, you know, dreams for the industry and also techie things. So grateful for you being here and making time for us.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Love. And thank you to everybody. We had people from so many places who joined us today. Thanks for making time on a Saturday to spend this time and share your feedback and your thoughts. And so much love to everyone. Have an amazing weekend.
Thank you.
Bye.
See you guys. Bye-bye. Bye-bye.
All right.
Jagopia.